Will, thank you so much for being here today and speaking
with us. Thanks, Alex. Thank you, Alex. Nice to see you.
Well, thank you. So the first question that I have for you is, can you tell us a little bit about your musical journey and how you got to this point in your life?
Sure. Yeah. So I started playing piano when I was 4 years old. I had really bad asthma when I was a kid, and I didn't really go to much of elementary school or preschool because I was like homesick a lot of the time. So I ended up practicing the piano for hours and hours a day. My mom got me piano lessons because she was like, this kid is sitting home all the time. Let's give him something to do. And I got really into the piano, and I was just super excited about it as a little kid. So I played classical piano and studied with a classical teacher growing up. And then in high school, I started playing jazz trumpet, and I played a lot of jazz. And then in college, I got more and more into jazz. And I played in a band called Yes Noise on the trumpet. And then I'm going like my whole life journey in music. So I played in a band called Yes Noise in college on trumpet. And then after college, moved to Brooklyn with my band and wanted to become kind of a classical composer because of my classical background. And I wanted to write orchestra music, and I was really excited about that. But I also was really excited about the music that my band was making. So I formed a group called ShoutHouse, which brings together some of my friends from different genres and hopefully creates a space where we can make music in the same place. And so now I still play some classical piano and I write music, and I'm sort of involved with different genres and styles.
Amazing. Incredible. No, I love that. The whole genre hopping aspect of your style. From what I listened to of your music and just of ShoutHouse, it's so, and actually Majel and I talked about this because Majel was saying how you're performing with Majel on the upcoming concert. And she was just saying, you know, you look at the music and you're like, oh my gosh, this is really technically hard. And then you play it and you're like, oh my gosh, but it's so accessible. So that's what I loved about it. Clearly Majel loves it too. So yeah, that's amazing. It's cool though to hear where you came from with all of that though. So thank you.
Yeah. I mean, it's been an interesting journey trying to find the right group of people to work with, because it's a combination of something that can be really technically challenging. Maybe it involves a lot of sight reading or a lot of listening in a way that can be very specific and nuanced. But I also do want it to feel accessible and also genuine and have elements of pop and other genres. So finding people like Majel has been a big part of the journey. And when I find a collaborator like Majel is able to do so many amazing things with her voice, somebody who I latch onto and try to work with for a long time.
Yeah, for sure. No, that's amazing. That's amazing. I'm really excited to hear the collaboration. Really excited for that. So I guess my next question actually would be, what are you going to be playing at the performance? And what can we expect to hear in that?
Yeah, sure. So I haven't actually had this type of performance before, one where I'm playing some of my ShoutHouse music, which is sort of intentionally multi-genre, and then some of my more concert music, which is like kind of for classical concert hall kinds of spaces. So I've never really had a concert where I've gotten to do both. So I'm really excited about that. This is sort of like a reunion show between me and some of my favorite collaborators from past years. So for example, George Meyer, who is an incredible classical violinist, but also fiddle player. He's a good friend of mine. I wrote a piece for him called Huts and Drones, which is off the last ShoutHouse album. So we're going to be playing that piece where he takes a fiddle solo. And then also Dizzy Sense, who's an amazing MC who I met, who's I think Brooklyn-based, Bronx-based, and she's going to be rapping some verses on that same piece. So I love kind of creating like a challenge for myself compositionally to see how I can get different elements to fit together in a way that doesn't seem like a strange collage of styles. So we're going to do that piece, and then we're also playing some chamber music. I wrote a piece called Machine Learning, which is for clarinet, violin, cello, and piano for Copeland House last year. So it's also going to have some elements of my more classical concert music style stuff. So I'm really excited about kind of bringing together a lot of different aspects of my musical life in one concert.
Yes, That's gonna be so interesting. That's gonna be so cool.
Sorry to interrupt, but there's one more thing that I'm really excited about is this cello piece, which I wrote. It's called Ghost Dances. I think this is the longest there's ever been the distance between me finishing a piece and me having the premiere of a piece. But I actually wrote this piece like 6 or 7 years ago for a close friend. And I gave her a movement and a time over a couple of years. And we've discussed having a premiere, but it kind of never happened. And when Preston and I were talking about this concert, I was thinking like, I could actually have a premiere of this solo cello piece that I wrote in like 2015. So wow. I contacted Arlen Husko, who's going to be playing the piece. And I'm super excited about that. I feel like I'm a different person now. I don't even remember what the piece sounds like, but I'm very excited to hear it.
So you're going to be hearing it for the first time with all of us as well.
Not the first time, but at least the second or third. Yeah.
That's so cool. That'll be awesome. Yeah. I'm so excited. Well, actually, this isn't your first time with performing with TNM. You performed with cellist Wendy Law and percussionist Justin Hines in the past. How did that all come about? We're talking about collaborators as well. How did you all meet? So I guess we're now going back in time. How did that happen?
Totally. So I met Justin Hines originally through being a teaching artist for the New York Philharmonic. I first met him at one of our meetings many years ago. And that program is called the Very Young Composers Program, or Bridge. And coincidentally, Justin and I worked both as teaching artists in that Bridge program and also for another teaching artist organization called Bridge Arts Ensemble. So two Bridge programs for young music students. So that's how I met Justin Hines. He introduced me to Wendy, and then we've played a few concerts together. Right before the pandemic, we actually went all the way to Colorado and we played a concert of movie music and jazz and classical in a trio form. A lot of fun.
Great. I know, I love that, because it's always interesting to hear how collaborators come together, because, you know, especially now, it is quite difficult to find people to play music with. And it's interesting. And thank you for sharing. Yeah. I love to hear it. As someone looking for collaborators always, you know, it's important.
Yeah, I mean, that's one other reason, of course, I'm excited about this concert is there haven't been a lot of live shows in the last year and a half for obvious reasons. So, you know, I'm having a few live shows these days over the last few months, but I think by February we should be in a pretty decent place with the pandemic, fingers crossed, in New York. So I'm really looking forward to having a more comfortable live show experience and being able to play with a lot of people and hopefully a good audience.
Yeah, for sure. Very excited. Very excited. So we've talked about your genre hopping, genre bending ways. But I also know that you are a classical pianist. And I saw on your calendar that you have a few performances of Bach coming up. And that got me thinking, how do you balance your composition career with your performance career? And when they intersect, how do they intersect? And how do you manage all of that?
Sure. Well, I would say that I like to have a career that's both in composing and performing, mostly just so that I can have a wide variety of things that I'm doing throughout the day. I think that if I sat here and I wrote music all day on this notebook all day, every day, then I would go crazy. So, I made a decision a long time ago to try to have my career be really half and half, so that I could be performing with people and also kind of breaking up my life experiences in a way that is, you know, varied and fun. So that's why I do what I do. And I would say that I separate my day as a composer. I usually write in the morning. I wake up early and then I write for a few hours. And then I switch to piano around like 11 a.m. and I practice for a little bit. And then I deal with like administrative things. And then in the afternoon, I usually end up organizing the things that I wrote in the morning and like following my own instructions from the notebooks to like put them into the computer, and then actually more having concert or rehearsals at night. I feel like I only answered like half of the question though. What else did you want me to? Oh, Bach. Did you want me to talk about Bach?
Yeah. Talk to me about Bach. I know that you, I've Preston, the artistic director, told me that you love Bach. So yeah.
Talk I do.
To me about him.
There are a few things I get so excited about as I do about Bach, but I got into Bach in college. I would say that a lot of my life has actually been defined by moments where I had like certain health problems, oddly enough. So like when I was a kid, I had asthma and it led to me practicing the piano a lot. When I was in college, I had really bad tendonitis and I was unable to play piano for a couple of years when I was about like 19 or 20. And I found that one thing that I could do without any pain in my hands was play Bach. So I started playing exclusively Bach for a few years. And, you know, I wouldn't say that I was that interested in Bach when I was in high school. I used to play like Rachmaninoff and romantic music and things that had a lot of notes, you know, because it's so fun. But when you get into the world of Bach, it's like a whole universe of music that is really exciting to listen to and play. And so I played the Goldberg variations in my early 20s and then got really into the well-tempered clavier. And then, you know, for a while, I was just like playing a couple of hours of Bach a day to break up my writing process. And then luckily, people are now sometimes paying me to do it. So now I can practice Bach for a financial reason too. So I'm playing Bach cantatas with a choir tomorrow. Actually, I'm playing cantatas 13 through 24 with the choir in Manhattan. And I've got a few Bach-related engagements coming up, which is pretty fun.
Incredible. Thank you so much. No, thank you for telling us about that. And like being so open about that kind of stuff, because I think that a lot of times it's ridiculous, but musicians are kind of weird to speak about that kind of stuff, but it's so nice to hear. And it's so nice that you are so open about it. So thank you. And it led to you, you know, finding this music that you're now getting paid for, but that you also ended up loving. So that's great.
The end, I would say that I'm very thankful for all of those different ups and downs of my life, because they've led me to this kind of weird and specific place and career that I have now. So, you know, while it was hard on the way, I feel like I am thankful for those obstacles.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So now, I guess that kind of leads to, I'm curious, just because you have, as I said, your music is so diverse. But who do you like composing for the most? Like, what instrument, ensemble, whatever, do you have a specific sound that you gravitate towards and that you like to compose for?
So one cop-out answer to this question is, of course, I like composing for everyone. And it is true. I like composing for everyone. One of the things that's really fun about being a composer is the challenge of the instrumentation. So you get a commission and they say, we need you to write for kazoo and viola da gamba, and you have to make it work. And that is sort of what ends up inspiring the piece. So I just wrote a trio for vibraphone and viola and cello. And I wouldn't say that's my favorite instrumentation. If you said that's your favorite instrumentation, you're insane. But the fact that those are the three instruments they gave me, it led to me getting excited about certain sounds and ideas. That said, I would say that I write my best music when I don't think about the weight of the tradition of what I'm doing. It's one of the reasons that I graduated from school and then stayed out of school and didn't go get a PhD, because I don't want to think about the music I'm supposed to be writing. And I think when you're in an academic environment, that can kind of get into your head. So I love writing for instruments like the saxophone, which doesn't have a really vast repertoire. It's a fairly new instrument. And so people are really excited about new music and they're not constantly comparing or trying to think about what the music's supposed to sound like, because it's a pretty new instrument. It's also why I get excited about the ShoutHouse instrumentation, which I hope is standard someday, but it's two rappers, a string section, flute, bass clarinet, drummer, and singer. So, you know, that I'm sure is going to catch on at some point. But the fact that it's such a weird instrumentation is really fun to write for, because I don't think about what it's supposed to sound like, and it kind of opens me up compositionally to write the music that I want to write in ways that are subconscious and conscious decisions. You know, I sit down and I really feel like sometimes I'm my truest self when I'm writing for that instrumentation.
That's really beautiful. Thank you so much for sharing that. It's, yeah, I mean, it is interesting. I can only imagine. Yeah, I can. I'm excited to see in the future what other crazy instrument groupings will happen. And I also will advocate for that, for the ShoutHouse grouping to become standard.
Please do.
Because it just has to.
It really does. It's, we've arrived in that moment, I think.
I think so. 2022, mm-hmm. It's happening. So my next question, actually, staying on the composition route, I guess, but kind of looking outward. Who, what composers or performers do you think are doing cool things these days, and who you're kind of keeping an eye on?
Yeah, totally. In terms of people not really associated with classical music, I really love John Batiste, Esperanza Spalding, Jacob Collier. I think those are, and Tigran Hamasyan, a jazz pianist who is also Armenian and inspired by Armenian folk music. Those are a few of the people that I get really excited about listening to. Gabriel Kahane, who is sort of in between worlds. Chris Thiele, who's also kind of, There's some really beautiful music that is being made right now that is kind of genreless, but is genuine and associated with whatever the person's background is musically. And I feel like those are a few people whose music, it just comes through really clearly what they're excited about and what they're listening to, but also in a way that feels really new and not too associated with any particular tradition. So yeah, those are a few people. Within classical music, there are definitely some like classical composers that I love. I study with John Corigliano. Whenever I'm stuck on a piece and thinking about structure, I always turn on a little John Corigliano, and I think about the way that he uses timbres and structures in his music. Thomas Addis, Andrew Norman, Caroline Shaw. There's so many great composers. Tim O'Andres. I could go on and on.
That is a comprehensive list, though. So thank you for that. I love that. No, it's yeah. Again, it's interesting to hear. You know, as a composer, as an artist, who are you looking towards nowadays or listening to? You know.
Yeah.
I also wanted to ask you something non-musically related, or maybe musically related, whatever you sure. really want. What are you excited about these days? What, yeah. I mean, anything. What anything. Is, yeah, what's okay. exciting sure. to you?
I just got the New York Times cooking app, and it has changed my life. I can't even describe how much I like it. Because in the pandemic, what else are you going to do but just cook? And so I've been walking down to Chinatown and Sunset Park, going to, like, fish stores and buying the weirdest fish that I can find that I don't recognize, bring it home, figuring out what it is, going into the New York Times cooking app and making food. So that's one thing I've been excited about. I'm a huge nerd. I get really into specific things like Bach or like, you know, playing the piano. I also have gotten really into juggling recently. I started stress juggling during the pandemic. Never juggled in my life, but my mom had these juggling balls and I was back at home the beginning of the pandemic. So I've gotten really into juggling. Yeah. So I'd say my day is like compose, piano, juggle, cook. If those are like the fourth, I do anything else. Those are the four things.
Incredible. Oh, that's so great. That is, yeah. And that is a look into the inner life of the 21st century composer. Honestly. Totally. Incredible. Mm-hmm. Incredible.
Yeah.
Do you think you'll do some juggling at the performance coming up?
I mean, it depends. Like, I double my fee if they want juggling. So we could talk to Preston.
But yeah. I'll bring it up in the next meeting. Uh-huh. So I have one more question for you. And, you know, it's what we ask everyone at the end because, you know, it's important. What is on your most listened to playlist right now? What is the last thing that you listen to? If you flip over your phone, what is there?
I think the most recent thing I listened to was some Oscar Peterson. I was, there's a track called Dancing on the Ceiling, which he recorded in the 90s. I was driving actually, and it came on jazz radio station. And I Shazammed it and then looked it up, and I've been listening on repeat to this Oscar Peterson track. I mean, it's just such beautiful harmonies and incredible that it's not pre-planned. It's improvised counterpoint. And so, yeah, I've been listening to a lot of jazz pianists, actually, in general. Fred Hirsch and Brad Meldow. Thelonious Monk. There's a lot of people who I would say when I'm kind of recreationally listening while I'm cooking or running or something, I'll usually turn on some jazz pianists.
Yes, I love that. Yeah, a few of our interviewees have also said jazz pianists. I think it's the time. It's cold.
It's the time.
It's just in the mood for the jazz piano, I suppose. I love that. Okay, yeah. So I'm definitely gonna have all those links in the bio to literally everyone you talked about today, which is many people. It's important.
So many people.
Yeah.
Amazing.
But I mean, Will, thank you so much for coming on. Thank you for being here.
Thank you, Alex.
We are so excited to hear you and ShoutHouse and Major Connery and everybody else on the 19th of February. I'm just, we're thankful that you came on, and we'll see you soon.
Yeah, it's been a pleasure.
All right.
Nice to see you. Thanks, Alex.
Thank you, Will.